Hello friends, this video on Wave Optics Part 9 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. Please make sure that you have watched all the videos till Part 8 before going ahead with Part 9. The only difference here is that since you have two different medium here, see, whenever any ray of light falls on the boundary, some part of it gets reflected and some part of it get refracted. So in the previous slide, we were concentrating only on the reflection part. We were ignoring the refraction part. But here, we will take into consideration the refraction part. So refraction comes into picture when there are two different media. And whenever there are two different media, the velocity of the wave changes, right? That means the speed of the wave now in this medium would be V1. And the speed of the wave in this medium would be V2. So how does that affect? The concept will still remain the same. Here also, this is my incident wavefront and this is my reflected wavefront, but refracted. In this case, this is my incident wavefront. And what about the refracted wavefront? This is my reflected wavefront, right? As mentioned before. And this is my refracted wavefront. Right? So this is my refracted wavefront. So now this line or this common tangent is the refracted wavefront. But in this case, the difference is that every time any point of the incident wavefront interacts with this boundary, what happens? It gives rise to secondary waves. Now these secondary waves will have velocity. What would be the radius of the circle which is formed? For each of them, the waves which originate in medium 1, they will have V1 into tau, and the waves which originate in medium 2, they will have a smaller velocity, because velocity in a, this is my denser medium and this is rarer medium. So velocity in a denser medium is lesser than the velocity in a rarer medium. So therefore this will be lesser, which is V2 into tau. So therefore this will not be a circle as such. The wavefront will not be an exact circle. It would be somewhat like this. Because in two different mediums, the waves will travel with two different velocities, right? So that is why you can see in this figure, they are not exact circles. The upper portion and the lower portion have two different radii in two different mediums, right? So the important point which is to be noted, see, the concept is still the same, just that you have to understand what is actually happening here. So when we were talking about reflection in that case, the two different medium doesn't come into picture. We are talking only about one medium, right? The incident wavefront and the reflected wavefront both are in the same medium. So we are not bothered about the other medium. But when we are talking about refraction, we are taking into consideration two different medium. So when each point of the incident wavefront interacts with the boundary, it gives rise to secondary waves which travel with a velocity of V1 in medium 1 and velocity of V2 in medium 2, right? So now as a result of this, we get these kind of pattern of the secondary wave fronts, and a common tangent joining these secondary wave fronts give rise to the refracted wavefront, right? So now this was the concept of refraction. So now using this, I mean, this diagram also represents the same thing. It is just a schematic diagram so that it is easier for us to calculate things. So here also, this is my incident wavefront, right? This is my incident wavefront, and at every point of time, it will generate spheres like this. See, here it will generate a sphere of V1 tau, somewhat like this. Again, at this point, it will generate a sphere somewhat like this. Again, some point, it will generate a sphere somewhat like this. Somewhat like this, somewhat like this, and so on. Right? So, right now, I am ignoring the upper part. Actually, it will not be a complete sphere. It will only be till here. Because in the upper portion, the velocity is changing, so it will be a smaller sphere. So, for now, you ignore the upper part. Just concentrate on the lower part. So, that is how we will get this refracted wavefront. So in this case, now when refraction is, when we are saying that refraction can be explained using Huygens principle, That means we can also explain the Snell's law. Please remember that here we are considering rarer medium to denser medium, right? So now, how can we prove Snell's law using this? So if you look at this diagram and if you consider triangle ABC, that is this triangle, and triangle AEC. So considering these two triangles, we can say that sine I, that means in triangle ABC, what is sine of I? It is perpendicular by hypotenuse. Perpendicular is nothing but BC. Hypotenuse is nothing but AC. So this will be equal to BC by AC. Similarly, in triangle AEC, what would be sine R? Where is sine R first? This is my sine R, that is the angle of refraction, the angle which the refracted ray makes with the normal. See, this is my incident wave front and this is the direction of the incident ray. This is the direction of incident ray, this is the direction of refracted ray, and these are the incident and the refracted wave fronts, right? So this is my angle of refraction. Now if you look at this diagram, this total angle is 90 degrees. So that means what would be this angle? It will be 90 minus R. So if this is 90 minus R, this is 90, then in triangle AEC, what will be angle C? It will be nothing but angle R, right? So sine of R is nothing but, again, perpendicular by hypotenuse. Perpendicular is AE and hypotenuse is again AC. So this, therefore, this will be equal to AE by AC, right? So now if you compare these two, if you divide both the equations, what do you get? Sine I by sine R is equal to BC by AC divided by AE by AC. That means this is equal to BC by AE. What is BC? BC is nothing but V1 into tau, right? We told that from point B to point C, how much distance does it travel? Velocity into time. So this is V1 into tau. And what is AE? AE also the same thing. How much time? I mean, what would be the radius at this point? Just now I told you, it will be velocity in this medium, which is V2. So this is equal to V2 into tau. So this is equal to V1 by V2. Now, we already know that the refractive index is related as n is equal to c by v. That is, refractive index is equal to the ratio of the velocity of light in vacuum to the velocity of light in medium. So using this, in our previous equation, we can find sine I by sine R is equal to c by n1 divided by c by n2, where n1 and n2 are the refractive indices of medium 1 and medium 2. So this comes out to be n2 by n1. And this is nothing but the Snell's law. Sine I by sine R is equal to n2 divided by n1. So this is Snell's law. So what did we see? We see that the Huygens principle was not only able to explain how the phenomenon of diffraction take place, it was also able to derive the Snell's law. So now using the Huygens principle, we can see that all the conditions of refraction holds true. Let us consider the first case where angle of incidence is greater than angle of refraction. So what is that scenario? When is angle of incidence greater than angle of refraction? When the light ray bends towards the normal. That means when the light ray moves from a denser medium to a rarer medium. So here we will see that according to Huygens principle, which velocity is greater? The velocity in rarer medium is greater or the velocity in a denser medium is greater? So what happens when I is greater than R? When I is, if we say that in rarer medium it is V1 and in denser medium it is V2. So what do we see? When I is greater than R, we say that the velocity in rarer medium is greater than the velocity in denser medium, right? And you can prove this from what we have obtained in the previous slide. In the previous slide, I already showed you that sine I by sine R is equal to V1 by V2, right? So using this, we can say that if I is greater than R, that means sine I is greater than sine R, that means V1 has to be greater than V2. So that means the velocity in a rarer medium is greater than the velocity in denser medium. Similarly, consider the scenario when I is less than R. That means this is my angle of incidence and this is less than the angle of refraction. Right? So what does this mean? This means that the ray of light is going from a denser medium to rarer medium, and that is why the ray is bending away from the normal. So in this case, sine I will be less than sine R, and therefore V1 will be less than V2. So the velocity in denser medium, in this case, if the velocity in denser medium is V1 and rarer medium is V2, then V1 is less than V2. So that means, what do we conclude? We conclude that velocity in rarer medium is greater than denser medium. So this was contrary to Newton's theory. So this was a major drawback of Newton's theory, because Newton's theory predicted something which was completely incorrect, right? So this is how Huygens' theory proved that it was not only correct, it not only could prove whatever Newton could prove, it also proved that what some of the things which Newton told was incorrect, and that is how Huygens' principle was accepted, and thus wave nature was established. However, wave nature was not completely established by this time. It was completely established only after Young performed the double slit experiment. Okay, so anyways, so this we saw for refraction when the light waves are moving from a rarer medium to a denser medium. Now let us look at the other way round scenario. When the light waves move from a denser medium to a rarer medium. So in this case, what happens? From denser to rarer, the refracted ray goes away from the normal. So let us see, how does it affect? In this case, we say that this is medium 1 and this is medium 2. This is a denser medium and this is a rarer medium. So this is my incident wavefront. I don't think I need to explain it to you anymore, because you have understood the concept now. This is my incident wavefront. So again, at every point when it interacts with the boundary, it gives rise to secondary waves, and the wavefront which is formed, it is determined by the velocity of the wave. So the velocity here, I mean the radius of these semicircles or hemispheres would be V2 into tau, and here since velocity of medium 2 is greater, let us suppose this is V1 and this is V2. So in this case, velocity in denser medium is lesser than velocity in rarer medium. Therefore, the radius of in the rarer medium is smaller and the denser medium is more, right? So in this case, the refracted ray would be somewhat like this, right? So here again, you saw the same thing, just that the only difference being here the refracted ray's radius, I mean the wavefront's radius is more as compared to the first medium, right? So on similar lines, what we did for a rarer medium to denser medium, you can prove the Snell's law in this case also. So if you want, I can prove it for you, but it would have been better if you try it on your own. So here also you compare triangles ABC, and you compare triangle ABC and triangle AEC. So what do you get? From triangle ABC, you get sine I is equal to BC divided by AC. From the other triangle, that is triangle AEC, you can find out sine R, that is sine R is equal to AE divided by AC. Now dividing these two, you get sine I by sine R is equal to BC by AE. Now BC is nothing but V1 tau and AC AE is nothing but V2 tau. So this is equal to V1 by V2, which in turn is equal to N2 by N1 in terms of the refractive index, that is sine I by sine R is equal to N2 by N1, which is the Snell's law. Also in this case, V1 is less than V2, because if you look at it, the angle of incidence in this case is lesser than the angle of refraction. Therefore, V1 is lesser than V2. Right? So using this Huygens principle, the total internal refraction can also be explained, because when the angle of incidence becomes equal to the critical angle, because total internal refraction is nothing but a special case of refraction when the ray moves from a denser medium to rarer medium. So it is a special case of this scenario only. So if the angle of incidence I is equal to critical angle, then what would be the angle of refraction? It would be nothing but 90 degree. So that means sine R would be 90 degree and sine I would be nothing but sine IC. Right? So in that case, what will happen? There would be no refraction and total internal reflection will take place. So there would be no refraction at all, only reflection will take place. Why will that happen? Because when I is equal to IC, the angle of refraction becomes 90 degree. That means this is your angle, the refracted ray is somewhere here. So if your refracted ray is somewhere here, your refracted wavefront would be somewhere here. So that means there would be no waves which will get refracted at all. The entire wave will get reflected. Right? So this is how we explain, because in this case, in that case, what here also, if you see, what is the difference between the two scenarios? In case one, we studied rarer medium to denser medium. Here we were studying denser to rarer medium. In the first case, you saw that we could draw the wavefront somewhat like this, but here the refracted wavefront becomes like this. Now, when it becomes, when the scenario of total internal reflection comes into picture, then the total, the refracted wavefront will go to infinity, somewhat like this, because these waves, you will not be able to draw an inclined line or an inclined tangent which will be common to all the circles, because there will be no refraction taking place under that scenario. Try to plot the figure for total internal refraction on your own so that it will be a practice for you. I drew it for three things. One is reflection, one is refraction from rarer to denser medium, and third one is denser to rarer medium. So try to plot the same thing for total internal reflection. If you are able to do it, that means your concepts have become clear. Right? So now we end towards the, now we reach towards the end of Huygens principle. But friends, please understand that Huygens principle is a very important concept and it forms the basis of wave optics. If you understand Huygens principle, you will be able to understand interference, diffraction and polarization. But if you have any doubts in Huygens principle till now, then you should get it clarified at this point itself before you go ahead. If you want, you repeat the slides, see it once again, and then go ahead with the next topic, right? So the basic funda of Huygens principle was that whenever you have a wavefront, every point on that wavefront will give rise to secondary waves. Those secondary waves will again form secondary wavefronts. Now a tangent which covers all these secondary wavefronts, they will form the position of the wavefront after some time t. So that is how the wavefront will keep spreading with time, and that is how the disturbance also spreads with time, and that is how the light waves also spreads. So it is not true that light waves always travel in a straight path. Light waves travel, or light waves propagate in the form of waves. Right? Okay. Thank you. Please visit examfear.com to watch free educational videos, try free online tests, get the best quality study materials, study from the best tutors and mentors, and much more. Thank you once again.